Not even 5 years now after the worst shooting at an American military base, it happened again this week at Fort Hood in Texas. As you probably know by now, Ivan Lopez, a 34-year-old specialist, he had served 4 months in Iraq and was back now stateside undergoing treatment for mental health issues. On Wednesday, he opened fire on his fellow servicemen and women. You know, when you think about something like this, can there ever be a satisfactory explanation as to why something like this happened? It doesn't need to happen. It shouldn't happen. We know that. We want to talk about it a little bit today. Retired Captain James Haig of the U.S. Marine Corps is with us from Washington. And in New York is Dr. Jeffrey Lieberman, president of the American Psychiatric Association. Thanks to both of you for joining us. Captain, let me start with you. You were deployed yourself 3 times. You say that you came back to your family a different man, that you had post-traumatic stress. When you hear the news of this week, what is your first thought?
My first thought is, what could we have done to help him more? Why did the system fail? Why did he give up hope? Because we needed to do so much more to help our veterans now. There are so many programs out there other than just the mental health system in the VA. There were so many things that are still out there, other nonprofit organizations, other things that are out there that can be done to help these soldiers and these veterans.
You know, Captain, I think that is the most salient point. Did something fail him? How difficult is it to get the help that you need? You went through this yourself. I mean, it's something that you've talked about openly. What you were able to get help. Why did it work for you when it doesn't seem to work for so many others?
I'll be completely honest with you. It took me almost 12 years to realize that I needed help. I went through 3 tours overseas before that I realized that I needed help. It takes a very, very strong person to realize that they need help within themselves. It took my wife and my friends to tell me that I needed help. It took my wife telling me that she was going to leave me before I needed to get help. So obviously something failed in the system because it took my wife to do that.
You know, what we know about him so far is that, you know, he seemed like somebody that you wouldn't look at and say there is a problem looming here. He said hello. He was friendly to people. He had moved into a new place with his wife and his daughter. Doctor, first to you, is there always some sign? Are there risk factors that people missed?
Very likely, yes. I mean, when we saw the incident with Aaron Alexis, which is a very different case, that was not PTSD. That was clearly schizophrenia or psychosis. There were many, many early signs that were missed and not acted on. In this case, by the accounts that we've heard, it's not clear that this person had any signs of being very severely mentally ill or prone to violence. But as you point out, he had had some changes lately. From what I read in the news, he had the loss of a grandmother and a mother recently in Puerto Rico. And he was grieving them. He had moved from where he previously was stationed at to Fort Hood and was reestablishing a new location, plus the fact that he may have had the remnants of the PTSD that may have been induced initially during his tour of duty in Iraq.
I mean, some of these stats are just really, they're awful, and they're unimaginable. A veteran's worst wounds oftentimes are the ones that we don't see at all. I mean, in 2012, we know that more men and women died by suicide than in combat. Military suicides are at the highest rate in a decade. 20% of all suicides that are happening are veterans. Doctor, when you hear stats like that, is there something that we have failed to do? I know you talk about mental health checkups, perhaps regular screening. Is there something else that we just said, look, this could make a huge difference, and we have just not done it?
Absolutely. First of all, our society, our country, overall, not just in the military, has really failed to try and provide what would be evidence-based, public health-worthy mental health services for people. And we see the problems with the homeless, with the mentally ill who are in jails, and the periodic mass violent incidents occurring as a result. In the military, the problem is compounded and more concentrated, and are producing these massive statistics of PTSD, of more soldiers dying by suicide than enemy combatants. What's going on here? So mental health care needs to be moved to the front as something that is a urgent priority if you're having an epidemic because of salmonella or E. coli, or there was some toxin in the air that people were succumbing to, you would be acting on it immediately. We're having this with mental illness-related complications, and we should be doing that.
Jason, let me end on a little bit more of a positive note. Something that I've been very interested in, and you obviously has changed your life. You're on the board of directors of a group called Canines for Warriors.
Yes, sir. Tell
me about the program. Tell me about what it's done for you.
Canines for Warriors, like I was talking about, the 32 different medications, when I was at my darkest point, I found Canines for Warriors and I got my service dog, Axel, who's sitting right here beside me, and I take him everywhere. If I didn't have him, I guarantee you that I wouldn't be sitting here today. I would be dead. I would have overdosed on one of those 32 different medications, drank myself to death, or ultimately would have become a statistic and committed suicide. We provide service dogs to wounded veterans with PTSD, traumatic brain injury, or amputees. We've provided 117 now to veterans throughout the country. We've had no suicides. We've had no suicide attempts. What he does for me is my Marines watched my back when I was overseas. When I came back home, like I said, you can't turn that switch off. And he is what is able to, for my brain to relax, because he is technically watching my back. He can do all other types of things. When I start to have a panic attack, when I start to have an anxiety attack, he senses that and he's able to lead me out of that situation. He also wakes me up from my night tremors, my night terrors. He can bring me my medicine. He can find my keys. He can find my wallet because of my traumatic brain injury. They can do anything that we need them to. We will tailor them to the specific needs of that veteran.
Well, I'm glad you're doing well. I'm glad you found something that can help. There's a lot of people, obviously, as we're all saying, that need to find that help as well. Captain, thank you so much for joining us. And Dr. Liebman, thanks for coming back on the program.
Sure, thank you very
pleasure.
Much.